Good evening. My name is Sean Hudgenwortel, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title for the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many, but we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh symbolized in his pure spirit state on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose operating throughout the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a scripture lesson of 2 Thessalonians, the second chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Marlon Love. We will have a prayer by Dr. Eunice Reiser, and that will be followed by a selection of music. Dr. Reiser?
Good evening, class. Let us all bow our hearts and minds in a moment of prayer and giving all reverence to Yahweh, our Elohim. I am so thankful, and we have been so blessed that he has given us this opportunity without any effort that he has allowed us to be assembled, that we can hear the word that he will present to us tonight, and that we just take it in our hearts and mind, because in those words, that consciousness lies within. And we ask that he continue to keep us strong, keep our faith in him, that he's operating all things, whether or not it appears to be or not. Things are not as they appear to be. And we give all glory to Yahweh our Elohim through his son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah. Thank you.
for him while he is near, while he can be found. If you really feared, you would search for him. He's everywhere. Yahweh can be found while there's still time to care. Thank you.
sedition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called Elohim, or that is worshipped, so that he, as the Almighty, sitteth in the temple of Yahweh, showing himself that he is the Mighty One. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? And now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now restraineth will restrain until he is taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed from Yahshua, shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause Yahweh shall send them a strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be judged to believe who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. But we are bound to give thanks always to Yahweh for you, brethren, beloved of him, because he hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth, whereunto he called you by our evangel to the obtaining of the glory of our Savior Yahshua the Messiah. Therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or by epistle. Now our Savior Yahshua the Messiah himself, and Yahweh even our Father, which hath loved us and hath given us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish you in the every good word and work. I have read 2 Thessalonians, the second chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Reiser, and thank you, Dr. Love. Today is Thursday. Thursday is reserved as of now for open testimonies. At this time, I would like to ask if anybody would like to give a testimony, and if not, then we'll just call a speaker. So, would anybody like to give a testimony at this time? Okay. So, for our first speaker for this evening's class, I would like to call Dr. Marlon Love, the Dean of the Ontario Branch. Dr. Love.
Good evening, class. Good evening. It's a pleasure to come again to stand before you, the Assembly of Yahshua the Messiah, in order to have some words to be said according to this great teaching, this great divine vision and revelation that we've been taught. We know over in Proverbs, it talks about a vision. And without a vision, a people perish. And without an understanding of this vision, within your consciousness, within our minds, we will perish according to the workings of Satan, if you would, or that evil one, or that wicked one
that is set up in order to deceive us. According to all that we've accomplished and with all that we've come to know about this physical world, which was a type and a shadow for us to learn something about our Creator. Romans 1:19 and 20 puts it best. If you can go ahead and grab 1:19 and 20.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them, for Yahweh has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
So it's the things that from the world that we have been given that's going to allow us to be able to clearly see what we can see in divine visions and understood in divine revelations, which is a form of Yahweh our Elohim, which is spirit. We say that this spirit manifested himself in a physical body. This spirit, Yahweh Elohim, was with Yahweh, pure spirit. And from out of Yahweh, pure spirit, in part, not in totality, formed Yahweh Elohim in a shape or form of a man in this state. But he is the whole creation in his entirety. Mm-hmm. He didn't just stay as Yahweh Elohim in this shape and form. Right. He manifested into this threefold tabernacle pattern, which was shown unto Moses, which was a key of understanding the threefold principal nature of Yahweh. A most holy place, after he'd drawn it down here, a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. This is Elohim, this tabernacle pattern. And then he proceeded out from out of chaos and or darkness in each day, showing to Moses his makeup. As Romans 1:19 and 20 eloquently put, from the creation of the world are clearly seen, because we can see this earth plane. We can see plants germinate from a seed. Mm-hmm. We can see how the sun and the water gives it the nutrients in order to vegetate from a dead state into a fruition state, mm-hmm. that buds, whereby it repeats itself over and over and over again. It's that witness that we see throughout all things in the earth plane if we're looking at it according to the mind's eye of the vision. And having to come to a profound understanding in order to have confidence in that vision for yourself. As we say, we don't care about one sensei, one's guru, mm-hmm. one's preacher man. They're not going to do anybody any good as things continue to manifest into this new year that's coming up. Mm. You can't go around and talk to them and rely on them wholeheartedly for your salvation. Because it's often been said, every tub must stand on its own bottom, mm. to be able to realize what it is that we're being taught here. For an assurity, without reservation, without doubt, and to be known that we've been shown a divine vision that came to Henry Clifford Kinley in the state of Ohio in 1931. We had a question asked the other night about the Sacred Name Movement having come out at the same amount of time in the 1930s that Dr. Clifford Kinley had a vision. And it's talked about that Dr. Kinley held off from using the names at that time, because how would it be that in 1931 our founder had the vision that had the names in it of Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua? He did not have a divine vision with Lord God and Jesus Christ in it. It may have made no sense with all that he's laid out before us for him to have just known about Lord God and Jesus Christ, and then later on through the Sacred Name Movement find out about the true names of Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. That's not the order of things. Dr. Kinley had the divine vision and revelation of the names. He deemed not to use the name for some 40 years. And that's power in understanding that and having a surety of that, that that's how confident that the founder was in order to lay this out in a prescribed way, in a prescribed manner, whereby it's not our thoughts, it's not our reasoning as to, well, he must have picked it up from somebody. He must have picked this up from somebody. He's used different things, like we use the Holy Name Bible because Yahweh made that available and put the Spirit in them to unveil that book. We didn't have no part of that book, but we can use that book just like we use everything in the universe to make the clothing, to make all the things, beautiful things that we see. We're just using it from the creation. And Yahweh's put that out in a certain fashion whereby he's not making any mistakes with this creation.
That's true.
He's not making a mistake when he gave him the name and he chose not to use it for some 40 years. That's not a mistake. Hey, we have to understand and realize that they didn't know the name of Yahweh during the time of Adam. Noah didn't know it. And Melchizedek, you know, and Abraham didn't know the name of Yahweh Elohim. They only knew him as El Shaddai. But we read in the book, Genesis 1 and 1, Elohim created. We read in Noah that Yahweh said this and Yahweh said that. But that's after having an understanding that is by Moses' writing of having had the name from the very beginning. And we say is that this beginning is where the Bible starts. The Bible does not start at Genesis 1 and 1. How and why? It's because this is where Moses received the name. Give me John 5 and 45, please.
John 5, 45.
Uh-huh.
Do not think that I would accuse you to the Father.
This is Yahshua the Messiah speaking in red letters written by John. John being an apostle. Apostle meaning he had walked with the Messiah for the 3.5 years that he was the Messiah, that he was in his ministry as a disciple. Now after Pentecost, we have John writing some 50, 60 years after the event of the death of the Messiah. And he's writing this. Read.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father.
Because he was there firsthand. And he heard Yahshua the Messiah tell the scribes and Pharisees and the people that had no belief in who he was. Mm-hmm. And he tells them this. Read.
There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom you trust.
And they believed in Moses because, hey, Moses is the one that wrote the law. We say the law is the first 5 books of the scriptures. He wrote Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Leviticus, and Deuteronomy. The scribes knew that. There was no debate about that. But what does he tell them? Read.
For had ye believed Moses.
For if you really had believed what you read, read.
You would have believed me.
They would have believed him because now he's getting ready to exit out of the scene. And he's letting them know. For 3.5 years, I've been walking with you around here. It wasn't the first time they just met Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
But now he's saying they would have believed all the things he said.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
For he wrote of me.
He wrote of him. Read.
But if ye believe not his writings,
yes.
How shall ye believe my words?
How is it going to be of any effect? Same thing with the vision and the revelation that our founder they gave to us. If it's going to be in vain and not really taken, how are we going to be able to utilize this for an assurity for what we want to be able to have a confidence in? And not be floundering and wondering what's going on. Do you know what the New Testament pamphlet is? On Tuesday night. We didn't quite get it finished, but I think some of the things that we were talking about were good in that it brought back some information. And we'll also probably get into the baptism because that was another question that was asked there at the end.
that I would like to maybe get into. Yeah. Do you recall where we left off Tuesday, Eunice?
Did you have it up on the screen?
Mm-hmm.
You're just going to start from
yeah, the
second paragraph on page nine.
There's a second paragraph on page nine?
Because we got into part of it, but didn't go all the
let's
way.
Let's go through. Ahead and start there and then see where it takes us, because I think it's good because it brings out other questions that we can get into, baptism being one that we'll talk about. And then we're working with the Old and New Testament or covenants. We talked last class on Tuesday about this first covenant, which was given to Moses atop of Mount Sinai. And he was told by Yahweh Elohim to come back down the mountain because he heard rumors of war in the mountain. We often associate them with having a party and celebrating this golden calf because they didn't know where Moses went because he was gone for 40 physical days in a fiery cloud atop of Mount Sinai with no food, no provisions. So they thought he was toast. So now we have an understanding that this first covenant was set up and was imposed upon them. And we understood or read that in this covenant that the children of Israel believed of Yahweh, and they say all that Yahweh say we will do. And they in this covenant was sanctified by blood. We understood that all covenants, like a will or testament, it has to be vindicated by blood or with blood. Mm-hmm. And we read in Exodus there of how Exodus 20, I believe it was the 34th chapter of Exodus, we have when Moses sanctified the people by throwing blood on them with the bulls and goats, and on all the vessels here at the base of Mount Sinai, which contained the Ten Commandment law. And we went through and talked about how Moses, on his third trip, because he broke the Ten Commandments on his second trip down, and then some 50 days later, he's returning back up into the mountain with his own tables of stone, was indicative of the new covenant that we're going to be talking about, by which we want to receive and have in us. We don't want to have to be reading Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We don't want to have to be turning the book to a flyleaf called the New Testament and in your consciousness feel that you're going to read what you're supposed to do
right.
to have the New Testament.
Right.
What we want to do is be able to show you by a vision that was given how the scriptures work in harmony from Adam all the way down to this present day. And it's by this second tables of the stone that Moses had to hew out to be taken back up into the mount. And the finger of Yahweh, again, wrote on that table of stone the Ten Commandments again. And it was brought back down after he saw a recapitulation of the 7 days. And then he saw all the way down the transgression he saw the other 33 days of Adam's and Eve's fall, or the transgression, down through the ages, or through the dispensations and ages, to the Messiah's death, right? Mm-hmm. That's what he saw for the next 33 days, down to Yahshua Messiah's death. And I believe even the up until the Pentecost, or outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And then when he comes back down, he has the table, he has this stone, the second set of stones. He had was able to make this put the stones into the Ark of the stone into the Ark of the Covenant, because the Ark of the Covenant contained Aaron's rod, mm-hmm. and contained a pot of manna, mm-hmm. which was fed to them in the wilderness of Sinai for 40 years, showing the evidence of Yahweh working with them and through them all the days of their life here in the wilderness and beyond. So that's where we got on Tuesday,
of trying to understand the covenant. And now we're going to be reading here with Apostle Paul explaining what?
Page 9.
Uh-huh.
Then the Apostle Paul explains when he said,
yes,
sacrifices and offering for sin thou wouldest not,
mm-hmm,
neither has pleasure therein which are offered by the law.
This is what he's talking about. He's talking about this law that they were given down here with this tabernacle being fully furnished and in place and working. They were given sacrifices daily upon this altar of whatever they needed in order to have their sins of whatever they sinned purged of them through an innocent sacrifice. This was the type and a shadow that Saul is talking about, or Paul is talking about, that they had to do day in and day out all the way up until that present time while they were with the Messiah on the fourth dispensation. Read.
Just in case someone didn't hear, I'm reading from Do You Know yeah. What the New Testament Is?
The pamphlet.
And that's the pamphlet, and on page 9.
Very good.
Then said he, Lo, I come to do thy will, O Yahweh. He taketh away the first covenant,
uh-huh,
which stood only in meats and drinks and divers washings and carnal ordinances.
See, he took that away. He took away those things that he did not find favor in. He imposed it upon the people. He set that up for the people to do, beginning with Moses and the children of Israel. That's why they were a chosen people. That's their only claim to fame,
really,
of having had been the chosen people. There's some others, you know, as far as their inheritance and things of that nature, that we can kind of perceive as far as their medical and money management, but that was all given to them as a history of people. Still, they don't do their souls any good. Whatever it was that they did receive carnally wasn't going to do them any good in their souls. They may have some physical perks here and there, but it's not going to help change the consciousness of their minds about what was imposed upon that people.
Hey.
Read.
That he may establish the second covenant.
And that's what we're talking about. The second. I made this statement that this was likened when he brought down the tables of stone the first time out of the second trip that he was in the mount. That was likened to the first covenant. It's not that Moses took up another set of tables of stone and that was the covenant, and it was brought back down. That's not what we're expressing. We're expressing the breaking of the first tables of stone was likened to what Saul just said here. He's going to take that away. The breaking of the first set of stones was the taking away of this first commandment or the first testament. But when on the 31st chapter of Exodus, when he brings up the new tables of stone, that's just it's a shadow, it's a likeness of what the New Testament is today. That is still contained the 10 laws that were put on the tables of stone that the first one broke, and he just merely put that in that tabernacle. So I just want to make that clear, not so someone that's not thinking that, well, we still are supposed to follow the 10 commandment law.
Yeah.
That's not the New Testament. That was a type or a shadow of what we're expressing to talk about now. Read.
Then if Yahshua came to fulfill the law and the prophets,
yes,
the old covenant, mm-hmm, rather than to institute,
yes,
something else of a natural or physical manner,
mm-hmm,
it therefore means that everything he did can be explained on the basis of something under the law,
mm-hmm,
and contained in the books of the prophets.
Now he's expressing that Yahshua the Messiah came in to fulfill, not institute. We talked about this on Tuesday as well, that he came in to fulfill. We can get Matthew 5 and 17, and it clearly states that he's come not to destroy the law and the prophets. And we're talking about the law being the first five books and the prophets from Joshua to Malachi. And that's what establishes the Old Testament of the book. That establishes that which he's come to fulfill. And it's by way of fulfilling we have an example. I'll just pick out one right now. The basic one is the lamb that the children of Israel had to take out on the 10th day, hold it over to the 4th day. That's likened into the Messiah or the spirit that was in Adam, taken out on the first day and held over to the 4th day when you got the Yahshua Messiah coming in and beginning his work. He was held over these days. You don't see him in the first dispensation, second or third dispensation. He's coming in the 4th here with Moses under the law. Mm-hmm. Just like he come in as a son on earth, like we talked in Romans 1:19 and 20. When I first started off, we have the son, the S-U-N, likened to the S-O-N coming in on the 4th day. So we have this lamb coming in and be having to be sacrificed on the 4th day. Now, the Messiah was likened to the lamb. We read that last class about John having said, "Behold, the Lamb of Yahweh come before us." We read that there in John 1 and 29, I think it was, 39, that he talks about the Lamb of Yahweh. So this lamb is a type of this lamb, or fulfilling what this lamb had to do. They had to kill it, spear it, drain the blood, strike it on the lintel and the two side posts, and dip from the basin. The principle of this blood, and we also went over our last class about blood, water, spirit 40, and how those words, blood, water, spirit, agree in one. Mm-hmm. So we're taking the blood principle here that had to be done, unless, if it wasn't, that death angel was going to kill the firstborn in every household, man and beast.
Right.
Egyptians didn't know nothing about that. They didn't have a vision, if you would. And without the vision, a people perish. Mm-hmm. So now these people, the Israelites, had a vision given to Moses. Moses told him what was going to have to be done with this, because this lamb had to be totally ingested. Well, if the ingesting is, that's eating the lamb. If this was the lamb and he's come in to fulfill, then we have to eat the words, because the Messiah said his words are life. You see? These are all types and shadows that we were believing and seeing the witness to what the Messiah came in to fulfill, starting with the Passover, if you would. And on April, you're going to see bunny rabbits and eggs trying to depict this event that transpired back here, not clearly understanding that the Passover is done away with, of having to do that in traditions or in customs. You don't need to do that anymore. And so this is what we're expressing, that Saul is expressing here, that the Messiah come in to fulfill. And we can see how from the lamb on the door, from the cloud, the cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night, all is pointing to Yahshua the Messiah. The Red Sea being the first veil depicting Yahshua the Messiah, because we said earlier that this is Elohim, the tabernacle. And if this is Yahshua the Messiah, the greater or more perfect tabernacle, is this migratory pattern. If we didn't explain this, this is the court roundabout in darkness or Egypt, which is typified of the world. The dividing veil here is the Red Sea. And then we have the wilderness of Sinai being the holy place. And then what divides the holy place from the most holy place in this instance, Canaan's land, is the River Jordan, or the second compartmental veil. These are the three compartments in the universe that we are using in order to point out Yahshua the Messiah. And you can see him and behold everything that transpired back here in the Old Testament. It's everything that he did in 3.5 years of his life to fulfill for the 4,000 years while he was on the earth. Got that? Let's keep reading.
When the Jews would ask Yahshua the Messiah, "Why do you do this, or why do you do that?"
Right, they're asking him questions, right?
He answered them thusly, "Search the scriptures, the law and the prophets.
That's what we just said. That's what we're not coming off the top of our head. We've been shown this. This lines up. This works. This makes sense, because you can't get any understanding out of the so-called New Testament in your Bible unless you understand something about the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. That's what Saul talks about in 2 Thessalonians. Don't be deceived, brethren. Don't let nobody just come tell you any old thing about the Bible, mm-hmm. about where you should go, what you need to do. Because it's a prescribed way. Read.
Search the scriptures, the law and the prophets, which were written before he was born.
That's right.
Not the books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John.
Just making that, just sticking that on home again. We talked about that all Tuesday, but just stick that on home again. The Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are not the gospels. Mm-hmm. Even though it says Gospel of Mark, Gospel of Luke, it doesn't make me any difference. Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
For in them, the scriptures, you think ye have eternal life.
Yeah, you read them, and you think you're going to use your own interpretation in order to gain something from there. You're not. Mm-mm. It's not a private interpretation. Read.
And they are they that testify of me.
Mm-hmm. Testify of me, not the me, you, not as you reading it, but as the Messiah says it.
Right.
That's the Messiah talking there. Mm-hmm. Read.
The first covenant, our law, stood only in meats and drinks, okay. and divers washings,
okay.
and carnal ordinances.
We went over that, okay?
Imposed on them, the Israelites, until the time of Reformation.
I'm going to get Hebrews 9 and 10. But that imposing is, if you get the word imposed, mean they had no choice in the matter. That's what impose means. Just like you impose a curfew on your child, they best be there and do what they need to be done. And in this case, the children of Israel did everything they were supposed to do according to the purpose of Yahweh Elohim. Just like Adam and Eve in the garden, people have contention about she should have did this or could have done this and he should have done that,
right.
and he should have told her. No, everything was by design. It was already laid out.
Right.
Your interpretation of the matter, it matters not to what actually happened.
That's
according
right.
to the vision. Believe it or not, call it Ripley's or not, but that is what Moses saw up top of Mount Sinai on the third trip, and he saw the transgression of the mankind. And he saw the darkness of mankind. That's why he had to come down the third time with a veil over his face, because he had full understanding or awareness up to the point that he was allowed to see, to have be illuminated in his consciousness about how he was going to have to deal with the stiff-necked people. Read.
Hebrews?
Yeah, we got there yet.
We got it. You want me to pick it up at 10 or at the beginning?
Nine and 10.
Okay. Which stood.
Oh, go ahead. This is where we got it.
Which stood only in mm-hmm. meal
mm-hmm.
and drink, or meat and drink offerings.
Yes.
And various washings
mm-hmm.
and carnal ordinances mm-hmm. imposed on them until the time of Reformation.
I just don't want you to think we're reading out a pamphlet that we just made up
right.
and we just putting all our own words in there. What we're getting from is from the scriptures. Written here by Saul or Paul about what's in the scriptures and what was imposed on the people. We just not writing this pamphlet up.
Right.
Back to the pamphlet.
Yahshua came to fulfill these natural, carnal, physical ordinances
mm-hmm.
and move them out of the way,
uh-huh.
nailing them to his cross.
Yep. So nailing him. We have it depicted here in a picture form. The 613 judgment statutes and ordinances, some of these are presented here. You got all the Ten Commandments right here. But the Passovers that we just talked about, that's why I said the Passover now, hanging out with the bunny rabbit and do the things of celebratory acts as far as thinking that they're going to be doing you a conscious favor
service,
of
yeah.
knowing or service unto our Creator is of no effect.
That's right.
It's vain, it's empty, because they've all been nailed to the cross. This is what he came in to do in order to free our consciousness so that we can have immortal glorification in the new earth state. But it has to be understood. Keep reading.
Okay. So that the true worshipers.
The true worshipers are going to do this in this particular way. Read.
Could worship Yahweh in spirit and in truth.
Man, you got the. That's a good question to ask somebody who coming to you. Say, how are you going to worship your creator or their Lord in spirit and in truth? Don't bring me baptisms. Don't bring me Lord's Suppers. Don't bring me no chicken to put on a grate. No Hail Marys. Those things are of no effect.
That's right.
He said we're going to have to worship him, Yahweh, in spirit and in truth. You can read, find that in John 4 and 24 if one's interested. We don't have to go there now, okay. But it's there. Therefore, read.
Okay. Therefore, when he was baptized of John in the river Jordan with the others of the Jews, not Gentiles.
We're only dealing with this chosen people. He was born under the law and died under the law to deal with this one particular people that were small in number, and they grew great. But this is how they had to go. Read.
Before the new covenant, a Holy Spirit was received from heaven on the day of Pentecost.
Yes.
He was fulfilling the children of Israel, no Gentiles, being baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the Red Sea.
And they did that by way of John the Baptist. That's what John the Baptist was out there, a wild man, in the River Jordan, baptizing the Jews and the Jews only in order to fulfill all that he had, all that Yahshua had set up or established back here with Moses. That was the purpose of water baptisms. Read.
Before the old covenant was given to them from Mount Sinai, when Yahshua the Messiah washed the disciples' feet, before they received the Holy Spirit and were to minister in the spiritual sanctuary, which is the body of Elohim, or the true congregation or assembly, he was fulfilling Moses, bringing Aaron and his two sons to the door of the tabernacle and washing their feet before he anointed them with the holy anointing oil, symbolic of the Holy Spirit, before they could minister as priests in the holy place of the tabernacle.
That's what we talked about last class. We dropped line upon line, precept upon precept. Here a little, there a little. We're talking about these water points. When when the Messiah is not on this chart, but when the Messiah is down here, was washing the disciples' feet, that's in principle to what the high priest had to do to be washed with the two low priests here and cover them fully with oil. That's the spiritual significance at the door that we have lined up with the spirit, water, and blood principle lines. That's what John is referring to. That's what he's looking back at. That's what he gives the witness to in order to why Yahshua washed their feet. Read.
Okay. When Yahshua the Messiah, Yahshua ate the Passover supper with his disciples alone in a place that they had prepared, he was fulfilling the eating of Passover supper down in Egypt.
This is what we're saying again. That lamb, what he had to do, what they had to do in order to get out of Egypt, because they were evilly entreated down here. Just like everybody said, this world and the presidencies and the problems that we have, that we're our conscience has us worried day in and night. We're talking about this world that's in darkness, that know not Yahweh, and he's dealing with a certain number of people down here, a certain class of nation of people, and this is what they had to do as a first Passover. And since then, they've been in traditions all up until this day. And the Gentiles just has taken that on, and they call it Easter, the Lord's Passover. And they fail to realize that he came in to fulfill that and to move it out of the way so you don't have to be burdened with that situation or that event or that tradition. And in your conscience thinking you're doing a good job,
right,
or as though you're worshiping your creator and thinking that this Passover has some semblance to what he wants. It's just no more dung as all the sacrifices they put out here on this altar that they worship unto Yahweh as a carnal, physical ornament. If you're doing it, it's a carnal, physical thing, Passover. Mm-hmm. But this is why Passover was set up. And is now we're going to read how it gets taken out or taken away. Read.
Eating of the Passover supper down in Egypt by the children of Israel in their houses, not in the temple or in the congregation.
Right. I mean, you can't come gathering. You don't have to worry about coronavirus. If they was really on it, they would probably correlate why it's good to have a coronavirus and everybody got to be at home and they do the thing at home. But they don't. They want to congregate in masses and pass a tray around with crackers and grapes and transubstantiation, changing the physical bread and wine into the body of the Messiah. That's a conscious thing. You have to consciously think to do that, to think that you're going to find favor unto your creator by doing that act. Read.
He had eaten this supper every year before this with his disciples.
Okay. Every year he's done this. This is a tradition. That's what they had to do back there. That was set up for them to do. Read.
It was a yearly obligation.
Yep. Every year, once a year.
Not only this, but he celebrated and kept all of the other Jewish feasts or holy days.
And these, that's an Abib. Aaron, a few classes, or even on Sunday, he talked about this Passover was in April. Abib, according to the Jewish calendar, and according to the Gregorian calendar, it is April. So that's the first of the year. Unto the Gentiles, or unto the nation of the Israelites, the Hebrews. That's their first of the year. People say now, well, it's not really the first of the year, January. Well, according to the Gregorian calendar, it's the first of the year. I'm not a Jew. I'm not a Gentile. Therefore, my first of the year is January. I'm not working. I'm working through understanding by using the Jewish calendar to understand the Passover, to understand the timing of things according to the Spirit, but not according to a physical work. I'm not running out in April doing anything with a lamb or a rabbit. That's all I'm looking at. Okay, read.
These were all types and shadows of the real or spiritual things, and there came a time when they were to be fulfilled and moved out of the way. Hence, the Last Supper.
Last Supper, meaning last, no more to do. That's Passover, called the Last Supper. But we, being egotistical, misdirected, many times try to take that up because it's familiar, it's comfortable, it's something that to you or to a person may make sense. But we're just expressing, reading down through here, and we're going to continue on with some of the other things that were taken away. Read.
It was the Last Supper of a physical or natural type, and it is no longer to be eaten in a physical or natural way. If one does try to eat it in this physical way or fashion, he doesn't discern Yahshua's body, which is now spiritual in this present age or dispensation. The Passover that Yahshua the Messiah ate with his disciples was also in fulfillment of the dedication of the first covenant that Yahweh gave to Moses and the Israelites at Mount Sinai, dedicated with the blood of calves and goats For when the Messiah took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But with the blood of a better sacrifice, the blood of the Messiah. But take heed what he said.
See, that's the Passover that he's doing that in. He didn't have blood in the cup. He didn't have wine in the cup. What did they have in the cup at the time of the Passover? Well, but bitter herbs and spices. That's what was consumed as a cup. That's why he said, that's why he gave him a cup. He's eating the Passover, the last one, and he's giving them, hey, take, drink, eat. That's what they did down here. He's not telling them anything new, but people's interpreted it as though that's something for us to do. And you because he said blood, he's the blood. It's the blood that he gave up on the cross, because he's showing you that the blood from the thorns on his head would be mounting to the lintel, and the two side posts would be the two nails in his hand, and he dipped them from the basin. That's the 4 points of blood that he's referring to. He's giving them bitter herbs and spices to drink, which is part of the Last Supper. And unleavened bread. Read.
But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine physically until that day.
See, they say the fruit or the herbs and things he put together in that mixture, that drink cup, there wasn't no blood in there. So they run and go get wine as though that's going to be the blood that he said. That wasn't the case. He said it was a fruit. And then he's going to be the last time he's going to do that with them in this way. That he's going to eat with them in this way. Read.
I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine physically until that day, the day of the kingdom that was established on the day of Pentecost.
Okay.
When I drank it new with you in the spirit in my Father's kingdom.
Yes. That's the day of Pentecost. That's 50 days after his resurrection, from after his death on the cross. Pentecost. We'll get to it again. Keep reading.
The above statement that the Messiah made at the Last Supper, when he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it unto his disciples, saying, drink ye all of it.
I got it.
For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. The disciples understood that the Messiah was speaking symbolically.
Symbolically. It's often said in the school, we teach using metaphors, similes, analogies, principles, in order to convey a message. Just like Moses wrote about a serpent in the garden. It's allegorical to Lucifer. We have Lucifer depicted up here because we understand that this is what Moses was alluding to about what the subtlety of what a snake represents. A snake does not talk, did not talk then, and there's not a snake that talks now. We're using symbols and analogies in order to convey a message. That whole book is set up in that fashion. Therefore, reread what we just said, please.
For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. The disciples understood that the Messiah was speaking symbolically, the bread as his body and the cup as his blood. Not his actual blood, as the followers of the Messiah thought then, and as some think today, who practice the doctrine of transubstantiation.
That's the word I just used, the 18-letter word, a transubstantiation. That's what people try to do when they're trying to fulfill or try to, in tradition, follow that custom of a Passover. And they do it some every Sunday. Some one Sunday a month. I don't know. I haven't been privy to having to do any of that, but I know that they do it at odd times.
just like they do baptisms in various different ways. First some got to get in, huh?
It's first Sunday. It's usually the first Sunday.
Usually, that's what I say, usually, but it's not always done that way.
Yeah, usually.
I'm just pointing that that usually is right. Always done some kind of a different way.
You're right.
All right? And the same thing with the baptism. Usually, they dunk them in a lake or a running river. That's where John was at. Many people try to find a running river or some running waters. Yeah. But some people right there in the church behind the pulpit. Mm-hmm. I've seen some splash water on
some people. Got spray bottles.
Different things. They got spray bottles. So they're doing all different, you know, COVID now, right? They can only spray. You know, they're making this event happen because that's what it said in the book to do according to their interpretation. It's not according to a vision. It's according to their interpretation. Mm-hmm. And all we're trying to do is teach and demonstrate and show forth some principles as to why that's erroneous, why it ought not be done. And you, to learn of the truth will set you free to realize that that water is not going to clean your consciousness.
Not at all.
Going to make you wet, but it's going to keep that same consciousness that you had before you got dunked, and it's going to have the same mentality after you got dunked. Yep. Let's keep reading.
For in the sixth chapter of John, mm-hmm. the Messiah explained to them before in Capernaum that it is the Spirit that quickeneth.
Yep.
The flesh profiteth nothing.
Mm-hmm.
The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life.
That's what we said earlier. The words that the Messiah spoke, they are spirit. They were the bread that he was speaking to them about eternal life, about himself. And that is the knowledge. When we run over there to grab me John
6:63.
Yeah, go ahead and read that real quick, and then I want to want John 17:3.
John 6:63.
Uh-huh.
It is the Spirit that quickeneth the flesh.
Yes.
But ye say the flesh profiteth nothing.
Do me a favor. Go to 62, please.
62.
Yes.
What? And if ye shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before,
mm-hmm.
it is the Spirit that quickeneth the flesh. But mm-hmm. ye say the flesh profited nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, and they are life. But there are some of you that believe not. For Yahshua knew from the beginning yeah. who they were that believed not, mm-hmm. and who should betray him.
So now, that clearly states, because we know he's from above. If we go to John 1:1, we're back here to be in the moderation. Or in John 1:1, most poignantly, that Yahweh, or the Word, in the beginning was the Word. And that Word was with Yahweh. And the Word was Yahweh. The Word was Yahweh. And when he transmuted or transformed in the vision that Moses is reading about, into Yahweh Elohim, a shape or form of a man at this particular time, took on shape and took on form, right? And then the 14th verse, he said, and this word became flesh and dwelt among us. One and the same thing. And so now we read here the Spirit that he's from above. This is where he's from above at. We have John, or John writing about, 1 John writing about this event here, how this word became flesh. Mm-hmm. So he's down here, and he's telling that he was from above. So that's letting you know that it's not a separate entity. It's not a little boy that was created and is doing his daddy's business. Not in that fashion. It's one and the same thing in two different manifestations. One incorporeal and one corporeal as a type. But really incorporeal here as well, because it is the spirit that was in him.
Right.
He was just able to be handled and touched in this form and walk with them. But then now we're supposed to worship him in spirit and in truth with the knowledge of who and what he is.
Right.
That gives us our solace to be able to contend with that spirit that's within us.
Keep reading. Oh, you read 63 already?
Yeah.
Did you get
17:3?
Yes.
John 17:3. And this is life eternal.
Joshua the Messiah is life eternal. That's where spirit is. Mm-hmm. Read.
That they might know that.
Knowing is having something intimate. You can't just know a person's name. Many people know the name of Yahweh, heard the name of Yahweh, or Yahshua, or an Elohim. But they don't know how to use that according to the scriptures. They either use all Yahweh, or they all use only all Yahshua, and call him still the Lord. Mm-hmm. They're not being able to see that that name and title and the manifestation of Yahshua Messiah is the Holy Spirit working through a body. For 33 and a half years, that's how that body got down in the name of Yahshua. And the spirit is called Yahshua. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're endeavoring to learn about in order to come into a consciousness within our minds in order to have eternal life. Mm-hmm. Still having to deal and haggle with the things of the world, but we're more temperate now. Because now we have a Savior that's going to work it out if we be patient.
It's true.
Read.
And this is life eternal, that they might know that thou only art the true El, and Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou hast sent.
That thou hast sent. He was sent from above, right? That's what he's saying over here in the Spirit quickeneth, and that he was sent. Or came down, right? So he came down from this incorporeal state into a corporeal state, manifesting as Yahshua the Messiah, died a death of an outcast dog in order to fulfill 4,000 years and this migration of the children of Israel in order to return back into that eternity or to that pure spirit state, if you would. Mm-hmm. Let's go back to the transcript.
This kingdom established on the day of Pentecost, mm-hmm, was the New Testament or covenant written in the heart and mind by the Holy Spirit,
mm-hmm,
eating and drinking in the Spirit.
This is the event on this plate here is showing the assembly of Yahweh, Elohim, in the day of Pentecost. This is the event that we have depicted 50 days after the Messiah resurrected. That the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and this is the New Testament. Understanding how this is the New Testament, and when we learn how it is and what Yahshua Messiah did come in to do, you begin to grow in that spirit, in that word, or in that knowledge about Yahshua the Messiah. It's said to know. Life eternal is to know the one true El and Yahshua the Messiah, right? Well, it's through his word that we read earlier that you're going to get some substance from, some information about this one called Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
The Apostle Paul, mm-hmm, the kingdom of Yahweh is not physical meat and drink,
okay,
but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
The Apostle John, who wrote Revelations, which, yes, is the spiritual revelation of the Messiah, said, behold.
This is in Revelation 1 and 1. He's saying, behold. Read.
I stand at the door and knock.
Uh-huh.
The door of our heart and mind. The new covenant. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him, mm-hmm, and he with me.
Well, that's actually Revelation 30 and 20,
right?
That portion there. Okay. But see, he'd, yeah, be saying, behold, I stand at the door and knock. I stand as Yahshua the Messiah. That's that spirit within your consciousness about what we're talking about, that he's going to stand in your heart and mind, where we said that New Testament is going to be written at. And so now we have that spirit going to stand within your consciousness and knock for you to perceive what he's been taught by way of a vision, and if you hear his voice and open up the door, and he'll come in and he will sup,
right,
with him.
and he with me. Mm-hmm. Sup means eat. Sup means digest. Sup means to know something, to learn something about your Creator or the one that is eternal life that abides within each and every one of us.
Break bread.
To break bread with, not wafers and crackers mm-hmm. at a building.
Right.
There's another time, there's another place, but you have to know the story to get out of that quagmire of what we've been imposed with. Mm-hmm. Granted, we've all been stuck with this egotistical, misdirected personality.
Right.
This is why we have this mosaic chart that says we takes our picture. Nobody's immune to it. We're not saying everybody should have seen it. That's not the get down. But yet when you do see how this Egypt represents the world and it's in darkness, as we can evidently see outside these doors, that they're running about every which way trying to find cures. Some wants to take it, some don't want to take it. And going into 2021 to this evening, and you're just hoping it's got to be better than 2020. Not necessarily so.
Looking for light.
We can hope, but if it's not, where are you going to go and what are you going to do? Yahweh said there will be no escape. There will be nowhere to run. The rocks will fall. And there will be an end date and an end time. And he said it's not going to be pretty. So if it's already bad with the virus, I want to learn all I can in order to be able to stand fast in the knowledge of Yahshua the Messiah. There's no work to be done. There's no, the grace of faith is by understanding and not by any works. And we sup within our consciousness. And this, I was saying that this chart takes our picture because we're coming from out of a state of ignorance. Ignorance just meaning not knowing. And we're coming into an understanding about knowing something about our Heavenly Father, which is going to bring us through a veil. And within this holy place, within this picture, we have steps, right? There's a particular function, a certain time that this candlestick had to be lit, 3 o'clock in the afternoon until 9 o'clock in the morning, because this tabernacle faced east, that S-U-N was able to shine into here and to keep this middle part constantly lit, no darkness here. With understanding here, this is where we can dwell at and understand with the intercessor being Yahshua the Messiah, intercessing for us unto Yahweh. The bread, we talk about supping, we just got done talking about the bread which gave them sustenance in order to be able to perform the duties within the tabernacle. So they're eating. So same thing with our life, that we should be able to behold, I stand at the door and knock, the door of your heart and mind. And the new, which is the new covenant, if any man hear my voice, open up. This is the door that he's knocking at into this holy place, whereby you're coming out of the sacrifices and the washings and the repeating down here, coming into the door whereby you're going to have some light or understanding. Isaiah 8 and 20 talks about to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, there's no light in them. Well, now to understand it, we see where that light's at. We're in the holy place. And we're supping here with the bread, with the table of shewbread represents. And we're intercessing. And what are we doing? We're communing with him. Mm-hmm. And he's our intercessor. He said that he's going to be the intercessor or the, he was with the disciples before he left. The what?
Mediator.
The mediator between Yahweh and man here, right? Or between Yahweh and you. And we're tearing down here. This was the work. They didn't go into the most holy place but one time a year. Just like that Passover wasn't done but one time a year. So it was about going into the most holy place in this tabernacle. One time a year, October 10th. There was a prescribed way. There's a certain number of times he went into this tabernacle in order to do the officiating of a high priest. And only the high priest was allowed to come into here and to perform the sacrifices that he did in order to be able to fulfill the yearly duty in order to free the people of their of their sin at that time. But what we're trying to do is get it to an understanding to free our consciousness of what we've been dumped on with this carnal, fleshly world, and how we're trying to make it to be something other than what is really designed for. Mm-hmm. Let's keep reading.
He that continues to practice these ordinances mm-hmm. physically further denies that Elohim who gave the law from Mount Sinai.
Listen what it says. Listen what it says. He that continues to practice these ordinances, 613 of them, by the way, and if you broke one, it was counted for you to have broken them all. Mm-hmm. So you can't break none of them. He wants perfection. Further denies, meaning turns down or poo-poos the information that we're delivering. Mm-hmm. Read that Elohim.
Denies that mm-hmm. Elohim who gave the law from Mount Sinai yes. had the power to fulfill it in the manifestation of Yahshua the Messiah, mm-hmm. or Yahweh in a physical body, and move it out of the way, mm-hmm. bringing in the new covenant, which is now spiritual.
Now spiritual. Read Galatians 3:16. You have it?
Yeah.
This is to the old foolish Galatians.
Galatians 3:16. Now to Abraham
yep.
and his seed were the promises made. He saith not, and to the seeds, plural. Mm-hmm. But to thy seed, singular,
yes.
which is his Messiah.
That's Yahshua the Messiah. That was the seed that came down through the loins of Abraham, through Isaac and through Jacob, down through this period of time, some 1,500 years from Moses, and then 490. Well, make it simple. For some 2,377 years, that this period of time, that the third age or the post-diluvian age carried on until the death of the Messiah. So from this promise all the way down to the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, where the Spirit was going to be able to be put in man, or that seed of Yahshua the Messiah be put in man in this fourth kingdom age, to fulfill that promise. Read. That's good with. Keep reading in Galatians. Yeah.
Okay.
Is that the end of 16?
That was the end of 16.
That's good. Eunice?
This also is the fulfillment of the promise that uh-huh. Yahweh made to Abraham. Yeah. That in his seed, Yahshua the Messiah, mm-hmm. he will bless all of the families of the earth, Jews and Gentiles. Mm-hmm. The Holy Spirit was also poured out on the Gentiles at Cornelius' house.
Now, 7 years later, after this event here, that first Pentecost, and then 7 years later, at Cornelius' house, you have the same event when Peter speaking to Cornelius and his family here, and then he have another outpouring. But he's talking about Yahshua the Messiah. He's still talking about the Old Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John wasn't written back here when Peter's doing this event. Right? It wasn't that portion of the people's Bible is not written yet. So you can't have any gospel preached to them through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So it required them to know the scriptures, and that was the law and the prophets. Keep reading.
The Apostle Paul admonished the Galatians in a letter to them
uh-huh.
who wished to continue under the Mosaic law or the old covenant mm-hmm. of works, such as meats, drinks, washings, holy days, Sabbath days, etc. Mm-hmm. They were ignorant of the fact that the old covenant had been abolished by the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, and the new covenant had been dedicated and established by his blood. This he proved to them in the scriptures as stated in Galatians.
Mm-hmm.
You want that read? No.
No, it's fine.
showing that Abraham's two sons were allegories of the two covenants, saying, "Tell me, ye that desire to be under the law, O covenant, do ye not hear the law?"
We're talking about the bondwoman of Sarah and Hagar. And actually, this is why we should get Galatians there with that.
That was...
We can go over Galatians, sir.
4:21. I got it.
I think it talk about them?
Yeah.
Galatians 4:21.
Now, this is allegorical. This is why the allegory. You got to remember the story of Hagar and Sarah. Hagar was Sarah's bondwoman. Sarah was married to Abraham. They were old in age. Sarah was barren, could not conceive a child. And at that time in history, they wanted children. They wanted to have a child, a male, to be able to continue on with the lineage. Abraham was 100 years old. Sarah was 90 years old. But the 10 years prior to that, Sarah not having any kids, gave unto Abraham her bondwoman in order to conceive a child for Abraham. Now we have Abraham consummating with Hagar and having Ishmael, the first child, 14 years older than the event when Abraham conceives with Sarah at her old age. But we'll go ahead and read it so you can see the gist of it. Read.
"Tell me, ye that desire to be under the law, do ye not hear the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondwoman,
the other
by a free woman.
Yes.
But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh."
That's Hagar. That would be Hagar. That was the bondwoman that Sarah, not having faith at that time, gave what she had to Abraham to conceive to have a child. But they were talking about allegories now, what it represents. Read.
"But he of the free woman was by promise."
As Isaac was by promise, because it was promised unto Sarah that she was going to have a child, and she scoffed at Elohim, talking about, "How would I be able to have a child at my old age?" So it's by the promise that we're talking about, Abraham having a promise. The promise was not given to Hagar and Ishmael in that vein. That was by the flesh. That was a carnal event that transpired. But now we're talking about a spiritual event with the seed, the seed that was going to be put into Sarah. Read.
"Which things are an allegory."
Okay.
"For these are the two covenants."
Those are the two.
"The one from the Mount Sinai."
Yes.
"Which gendereth to bondage, which is Hagar."
This is Hagar. This Ten Commandments stones that Moses brought down out of this mountain after 40 days and was placed into this tabernacle represents Hagar, the bondwoman, Ishmael, or the Ishmaelites, if you would. Right? Read.
"For this Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and answereth to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. For it is written, Sing, O barren, thou that didst not bear, break forth into singing and cry aloud, thou that didst not travail with child. For more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married wife. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. Nevertheless, what saith the scripture? cast out the bondwoman and her son.
Mm-hmm.
For the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman.
Mm-hmm.
So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free woman.
And so we're understanding now, we're getting rid of this type of law that was physical and fleshly. And we're coming into a consciousness of the promise, which is derived through Isaac and through Jacob. Jacob's name changed into Israel. And then now you have the migration of the children of Israel. That's why we rehearse that migratory pattern, to understand what it takes to have that spirit in you, to comprehend and to understand the spirit that was in Yahshua the Messiah, and how it's going to ultimately be in you through understanding, how it's going to be written in the heart and mind within our consciousness, to know about that allegorical situation. Mm-hmm. And we can run that allegory all the way back down to Noah and his kids, as far as the lineage of the free and the bond, and how you're going to have the elder serving the younger. Because you remember with Ham here, where was that at? Ham was on the chart back there.
You want it?
I don't want it. That's just another allegory to the seed and how that seed came down through Seth. Seth was the youngest, and Joseph was going to be in the tent with Seth up here in Canaan's land as the story goes on, and then Ham being the one that was going to be having Cain later on down the line where you get Tower of Babel through Ham's lineage, because Ham saw his father's nakedness.
Right.
So it wasn't, the curse wasn't on Ham himself, it was on his son, which was Cain. And this is when they begin to build this tower, begin to build this Tower of Babel here. But that's another story. But again, it's allegorical to that seed or to that promise. Back to the transcript or to the pamphlet.
For it is written, mm-hmm, that Abraham had two sons.
We're gonna hear
one
it again.
Son Ishmael,
yeah,
by a bondwoman, Hagar, born after the flesh, which was an allegory of the first, our old covenant,
mm-hmm,
written on tables of stone and given to Moses and the Israelites from Mount Sinai in Arabia.
Right.
An answer to the earthly Jerusalem, which now is and is in bondage to the natural carnal ordinances that were given to physical Israel under the law with her children.
That's Ishmaelites doing those things as a type or a shadow, if you would. They want to be beholden unto this and worshiping and going through the same ceremonies to this. That's your prerogative. That's your will. But let's keep reading. See what it says about Isaac, the other son.
The other son, Isaac, was by Abraham's wife, Sarah.
Yes.
Sarah was barren, and Abraham was 99 years old, which is past the age of bringing forth physical children.
It's also typifying the will of Yahweh to be who he wants to be. Ir Asher Ir. I will be who I will to be. Not I am that I am. If it was I am that I am, then Abraham wouldn't be able to have any kids. That's right. The meaning of what it talks about, I am that I am. And at 99 years old, this promise is going to come upon Abraham. Read.
Mm-hmm. Contrary to a natural birth in the flesh, and according to Yahweh's purpose.
Uh-huh. Contrary to the flesh. We're not dealing with fleshly things here. We're not trying to make you make money and make you make happy physically, fleshly so.
True.
This is not what this school is about. The school is to help us teach and learn of Yahshua the Messiah, whereby we can sup with him when he knocks on our consciousness, so that we're aware of who's knocking and what's knocking. And so that we're not deceived, and we can avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or the demons that befall us every day.
Yep.
So we're trying to learn about this, and it's not physical. That's why he took Abraham at 99 years old and was able to give him seed through Sarah. And Sarah even laughed at it later on down in the script.
For real.
Because how could it be so? Because they're looking at it physically, consciously so. But now, now we can look and read and see. And don't be surprised, because the Messiah told the disciples, we're going to do greater things than he. But you have to have belief and faith in the report. All we're doing is going over the report. I may not be as articulate as many of the other speakers and whatnot, but we have training wheels that we're working with, and they're right on time. But we got to believe it. Slow down a little bit. I've seen things that strengthens, and it helps. Let's keep on reading about Isaac.
Contrary to a natural birth in the flesh, and according to Yahweh's promise and purpose to establish an allegory,
See the allegory word come up again? It's establish it. Read.
Sarah, a figure of the heavenly Jerusalem, was overshadowed and impregnated by the Holy Spirit.
Same way that Mary was, that conceived Yahshua the Messiah. She was overshadowed by Gabriel, the archangel, at that time of conception, when Yahweh deemed it to be void of any physical man. Even Joseph wanted to put her away because he didn't know her. He didn't know her. He didn't understand. He didn't conceive with her. Mm-hmm. That's what the knowing is talking about. When when Adam and Eve conceived, it talks about, I believe it was the fourth chapter, when Adam knew his wife Eve, then they were able to bear Cain. Mm-hmm. But see, the physicalness of that statement, Eve says, now I've got me a man child. That's a faux pas in her speak. That's understanding that evil one was already dwelling. And you know that you can pick it right up here in Cain. Because Eve, not knowing the purpose, was deceived and was able to say that she had gotten her man to. All things belong to Yahweh and Yahweh alone. Mm-hmm. So in that statement, you already can point out by a type of what Cain was going to be by way of Eve. But let's keep reading. Sorry to interject.
And impregnated by the Holy Spirit, bore Isaac, which was synonymous to the second table of stone, a figure of the new covenant that Moses himself hewed out and took into Mount Sinai the second time.
Mm-hmm.
After 40 days in the mount the second time, Moses returned to the camp with the law written on tables of stone by the finger of Elohim, and his face shone in so much that Moses had to put a veil upon his face.
We talked about that earlier. When he came down that third time, Moses had to put a veil because he was able to see, was enlightened by the events that was transpired after the transgression, and saw what was going to happen at the end. Spiritually so, not physically so. That's right. Let's just keep reading.
Face to talk with the children of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
The second table of the covenant was given to Moses, and his face did shine, symbolic to the Holy Spirit in Moses.
Symbolic to the Holy Spirit. We're talking about the Old Testament now with Moses. Why we can go back to Moses and understand what Moses was experiencing and going through and what it depicted symbolically. And that way we can see it spiritually according to our consciousness now of how the things were set up and how when we are able to get a revelation about this great mystery and how we can be illuminated and pressure be taken off of our consciousness about a matter. And we can turn it over to Yahshua the Messiah and ask Yahshua the Messiah when we sup with him and when we begin to know him, he will be able to reveal the things in here and in the world. So, well, we might have confidence in the scriptures, in the report, and in the vision most of all, whereby if you know not the vision, you're subject to perishing.
Mm-hmm.
But let's keep reading.
Was synonymous to Isaac born of Sarah by promise and not the will of the flesh, and is allegorical to the new covenant written in the heart and mind on the day of Pentecost. In fulfillment to the promise given of Yahweh unto Abraham. Also, the Abrahamic promise was necessary because all men had been concluded under sin due to Adam's transgression, and the law of carnal ordinances and commandments given unto Israel was 430 years after the promise and could not annul or make void the promise, for the law was given to be a schoolmaster to lead us unto Yahshua the Messiah.
That's good for a minute. This law, or that promise, was given 430 years before they married Yahweh here in this first covenant, right? It was 400 years from that event with Isaac, or the promise that was given to Abraham, and that all the generations, or the whole world, were going to be saved through the promise seed at the end of the events that were going to transpire, that was already preordained, that 430 years later, you're going to have this man Moses having with these people from out of Egypt, and they're going to be bonded with this first covenant, the do's and don'ts, the Ten Commandments that we all want to, many try to strive to do. And what we're saying is now, after 1,500 years later, you have Yahshua Messiah coming on the scene, and Yahshua Messiah is now going to fulfill, jot and tittle, everything that this covenant was symbolic of, and wrap it up so that we can learn about how he did it, when he did it, why he did it, in order to learn of him. And the spirit within us, with our belief, is going to elevate us and illuminate us in understanding about who we are and what we are, according to a purpose and a plan of Yahweh, not of our own traditions and customs. We'll have a new heart and a new mind, written of the Holy Spirit by spirit law, where we'll be governed and we'll not want to move and deviate and be a stiff-necked people. We'll embrace the law that Yahshua puts in us, whereby we know why and what he's done and what he's able to fulfill. This happened 2,000 years ago. We don't want to go back to this bloody mess. We want to be able to walk through whatever's coming up in our future and in our life with a clear conscience, under the guise of the Holy Spirit, not under the guise of a man-made law. And it was a schoolmaster to lead us up to the Messiah. We're not going to have to be able to do away with the information, because we want to be able to teach and be able to share with others. That's the gift of life. Those are the words we speak and teach by way of the Holy Spirit in us, to be able to bring somebody else out of that darkness that they know not Yahweh, in order to give them the information just as we received it. Saul there in 1 Corinthians 15 chapter talks about the report that he received. He didn't work up on it. It was the report that he received, just as we are receiving it now. And just as Dr. Kinley was asked of Yahshua, what are you going to do with this that I gave you now that you see what I've shown you? He couldn't even answer it. But it was, when he and that spirit got in him, that spirit was able to say, teach your people. Teach your people. Therefore, we, in like manner, Dr. Kinney said he wants to make ministers in order to do what? To be able to teach his people. So it's a repeat. Just like that seed is going to be planted in the ground. It's going to be watered. And by way of that sun and sun rays that's going to come down on that seed, it's going to germinate. But the seed going to, that seed's not going to make more seeds.
Right.
It's going to make fruit. We're the fruit of his labor that he died on the cross for. So now we become his fruit or offspring. All we have is seeds in us in order to plant right back again. And that repeat goes over and over until he calls it good. And the whole family is restored unto him as he sees fit, not us. So all we can do now with the heart and mind with the Holy Spirit is to come to class and to learn the things of Yahweh, whereby we might be perfect and found doing his will and not ours. Let's go ahead and read, because we're almost finished. We can get through this.
Now that Yahshua is come and fulfilled the old physical law of commandments contained in physical ordinances mm-hmm. and moved it out of the way, mm-hmm. the true worshipers of Yahweh are worshiping him in spirit and in truth,
mm-hmm.
not in the letter of the law, but in the spirit with the new covenant written in their hearts and minds.
So that's what I was trying to sum up there a little bit. Let's keep reading.
The Apostle Paul, seeing that this new covenant is written in the hearts and in the minds, wrote to the Corinthians thusly, ye are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read of all men.
Now that's why you get the New Testament, when you understand what the Old Testament is talking about, then we can run to the epistles of Acts, of Romans, of Galatians, because they're talking about the things of the Old Testament. You can't learn nothing through the do's and don'ts of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There's not enough information if it was to be followed. So when we have the real right story of knowing who he was and learning about the Moses in the migratory pattern all the way back to Adam and Eve, because that's when death started with Adam, that came down and it rained all the way into Yahshua the Messiah. And when we know about that, then we'll be able to get somewhere. Read.
Ye are our epistle written mm-hmm. in our hearts, known and read of all men.
In our hearts. Read.
For as much as ye are manifestly declared mm-hmm. to be the epistle of Yahshua the Messiah, ministered by us.
But I just said that. I didn't read this script today. And we're talking about the same thing. We're ministers under the same word that we've been that we received in order to bear fruit for Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
In the spirit of the matter. Not everybody's going to come. But when we preach towards good works. Mm-hmm. That all men can be made found perfect in Yahshua the Messiah. In him, how? Knowing about him. Mm-hmm. Being aware of him. Whereas his yoke is easy and light and burdensome. And not burdensome, if you would. Yeah, right? You don't have that yoke. Huh? Less burdensome.
Yeah. His burden is light.
His burden is light. That's what I needed right. to say. His burden is light. Come unto him, for his burden is light. Right?
Yeah.
That's what we want to get to. That's what people pray for. Just keep reading.
Written not with ink, yep. but with the spirit of the living Elohim.
Yes.
Not in table of stone, but in the fleshly table of the heart.
Yes.
Now, since you are the epistle.
You, us. He's dropping it off the pamphlet. This is the pamphlet of H.C. Mm-hmm. Kinley writing to us. Now, you, who are the epistle, read.
And it takes many epistles up a book.
It makes many epistles to make up the book. And we're going to find out who that book is, read.
As we being many members uh-huh. make up the body of Yahshua the Messiah.
According to the spirit of the matter. We learning and knowing are going to take on that perfect foundation of power and strength of Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
John confirms it by his vision on the Isle of Patmos mm-hmm. when he says, I saw the dead, small and great, stand before Yahweh, and the books, our epistle, which is each of us, were open, mm-hmm. and another book, mm-hmm. the body of Yahshua, or the totality of the redeemed ones, was open, which is the book of life. And the dead was judged out of those things which were written by the spirit of the living Yahweh in the books according to their works.
Revelation. That's beautiful. In the summation, I don't really have nowhere else to go with that end all be all. Almost how much time speechless. We got, brother?
We got 7 minutes left. 7 or 8 minutes.
I'll just say, in conclusion, I enjoy having gone through this little workshop, 2-day workshop we had today, bringing in the new year this evening for here in California. Other places already the new year, understanding that. But we have a great teaching, a great doctrine by which to learn many, many things to clarify and to make known and prove who Yahshua the Messiah is. That's our profession. That's our obligation to know more perfectly and realize that when we do something repetitively, it becomes understood, I'll say osmosisly, because it's the spirit in us that's going to be able to carry us through whatever situations we're going to be faced with. And if we go ahead and pick up 2 Thessalonians real quick and maybe get down to the
2 Thessalonians
2 and 7?
No.
Yeah, just get 2 and 14.
Okay.
And we'll be about done with that. Because I want to give this gospel as a gospel of reconciliation, right, of restoring, as we just read there at the end of that pamphlet here. It's restoring the true spirit in us in order to be witnesses unto Yahshua the Messiah, which are the true witnesses to show forth by the law and the prophets to prove who he was and what he came to do. But yet Thessalonians, it reads here thusly, whereunto?
14th verse. Whereunto he called you by our evangel.
That's by the evangel, by preaching of the gospel. We've all been called that are able to hear. That's why we would say we're thankful to say something to the assembly or the body of Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
To the obtaining of the glory of our Savior, Yahshua, the Messiah.
And we, how do we attain this? How do we come about knowing about this? It's by blood, water, spirit, 40. Blood, water, spirit, 40. This is a foundation to get a person set up, because we know that that schoolmaster is the Old Testament to lead you up to the Messiah. But you can't run in there and read it any old kind of willy-nilly way. So if we understand how it's set up with these principles that are unerring and don't change, we can have that confidence in order to springboard off. But we always got to come back to the basics. Mm-hmm. In my work, I didn't know how to do what I used to do 10 years ago. Now I still do the same basic things that I learned 18 years ago. It's all relevant. I just do them without having to watch and see all that I used to have to watch and see. You know what I'm saying? It just becomes automatic because you trust and you know that when you do something, it's gonna do what it said. It's gonna do what it's designed to do. Mm-hmm. And this gospel is designed to be able to bring one out of ethereal black darkness or confusion. And that's what this gospel is set up for, in order to bring a person into a state of who and what they are. Keep reading Thessalonians, please.
Therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or our epistle.
Either by word, because we're preaching or we're reading, but this is the tradition of the customs of the gospel, of the report, is their only traditions. He's not talking about traditions of doing anything physical. That's not the tradition. The tradition is how we're getting this knowledge. This is why Dr. Kenny said, come back to class. Come and get all that you can get. Because that's the tradition of how the word is being delivered. That's just how we're supping with one another, according to getting this divine information, this divine food, if you will, according to tables on a chart. Read.
Now our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah himself,
yes,
and Yahweh, even our Father,
yes,
which hath loved us,
yes,
and hath given us everlasting consolation,
yes,
and good hope through grace.
Good hope through grace, without works, but with steadfastness in the gospel of learning about Yahshua the Messiah. Read the last verse and we'll be out of here.
Comfort your hearts.
Yes.
And establish you in every good word and work.
That's what we do. Establish ourselves in this good gospel. Learn what we can learn and love one another and teach one another what it is on your heart and mind in order to satisfy and to edify one another in all good things, so we can come together anywhere, in any condition, in any situation, be it good or bad, and know that Yahshua Messiah is on our side. With these few words, I hope you got something out of this evening's class, and thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Love. That will conclude this evening's lecture. Do we have any announcements tonight? No? All right. We will be continuing our winter series of lectures this Sunday. This Sunday will be Rebecca Alanis' turn. What will you be going over again? Okay, so this Sunday's lecture will be going over how the natural shows forth the spiritual by the pattern of blood, water, spirit. So tune in for that, because I'm sure it'll be interesting. She always comes in well prepared. That will conclude this evening's lecture. I already said that. Any and all donations can be had by our treasurer, Dr. Eunice Reiser. We hold classes here every Tuesday and Thursday from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and every Sunday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truly the place to be. Let us all stand to be dismissed by the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.